Okay. Welcome to our first meeting of 2016. Hope everybody had a happy new year. Normally we start with public comment, but since there's no members of the public here, we'll go to approval of minutes. Motion to approve?
Second.
I see one little edit. DPW tree crew. In the second line, Tony spoke about residents' reactions.
Any other comments? Please don't edit all of my email like notes for grammar, because that was not my intention. We'll be here all day.
Okay.
So I did scan them and I thought they looked good. So we have a motion and a second.
Yes, second.
Okay, yeah, I think we already have some. So approval to, I mean, motion, vote to approve the minutes as amended. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Minutes are approved.
I abstained just because honestly, I didn't get them earlier today, so I haven't read them. I trust that they're okay. Good, but.
All right, one abstention. Okay, review of the to-do list. I actually didn't go in and amend it. I have to look up. One thing I want to do with you, Rich, I know it's on my to-do list, is you have a contact with Smith Volk for doing graphic stuff.
Yes.
Yep. For the watering door knocker,
yes.
Door hanger.
Yes.
So let's, you and I, can you send me that person's contact? Sure. Should I contact that person directly?
You can.
Okay.
But it might be easier for me to go over there. Maybe you can go over together.
Go in person?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, it usually works a little more effective.
Okay. All right. Let's make sure we do that. Let's see. There's actually nothing highlighted on here. So that means that there's nothing that I felt was urgent. Urgent things we did last time. All right. So that's that piece. And then chair report. So what do I have here on my chair report? One thing is Jen informed me that she's leaving the meeting at 5 today.
Yeah.
So one part of the agenda that I hoped you'd be here for was the discussion about volunteer organizing. So I'd like to make a proposal, since Marilyn doesn't need to give as long a survey summary, and those things could be flipped, that we actually discuss the volunteer organizing piece at 4:48, so that Jen can be part of the volunteer organizing conversation.
Cool.
Is that okay with everybody?
Yes.
Okay. So I sent a thank you letter to the mayor that everybody signed. And I also sent him the letter that I think I shared with everybody about the DPW director selection process. I did not hear back from him. And I did go to the city website, as I think I shared with you guys, and I sent you the link. And I don't see in the description any reference to green infrastructure or trees, which frankly, reading the description didn't surprise me, because the description didn't go into details like that. Like, it didn't talk about our flood control, you know, whatever street. So I'm just curious, and we can say this for later, whether or not you, like, he reacted to our letter at all to you. He didn't. All right, does anyone want me to follow up with this, or do you feel like we did our bit and we leave this one?
Well, are we going to hear anything again about the selection? I think we will. There'll be some kind of open forum eventually.
Well, once all the candidates have been, once they determine whatever the posted date is going to be, they will take all the candidates and they will just, there'll be a screening committee that's going to actually go through the actual written resumes, and mm-hmm. they will determine which ones move forward to the mayor. Now, I'm not privy to, at this moment, of where that is at. I have no idea how many applications are there. I don't have any idea. I mean, I can ask him.
Well, I'm just wondering if somewhere along the way before final selection, whether we can insert some of our interests.
Somewhere. Well, I would think that, and I would hope that, my assumption is the person's going to be from the outside. It's not going to be an internal candidate. So my assumption is that there will be some type of potential for the public to interview the individual similar to what they did when the police chief was selected. Fire chief was a little different, so. So I think there will be time for that.
Okay. One thing, I do feel like the job description aspect is done.
Yeah, that's correct.
Yeah. So I feel like I could potentially go back and say, hey, just follow up, did you receive my letter? And if it's not too late, is it possible that an interview question be shaped to discuss this topic?
That would be fine. He doesn't typically respond to, did you send it to his own personal email?
I sent a hard copy.
Yep.
And I did send it to, I sent it to Mayor.
Mayor, yeah, I'm surprised that no one responded. Usually someone in the office will respond. He doesn't typically respond to his emails that are addressed to Dean Harkowitz.
Yeah, I sent it to Mayor. All right, well, if folks feel comfortable with me following up with that, okay, so I will do that. And let's see, all right, two more things. One is, I just sent you, I think, it may still be in my draft box. The communication I had with the co-sponsors of that significant private tree ordinance, Jesse Adams and Ryan O'Donnell. So I sent a follow-up per everyone's request that just clarifying that, you know, we support the ordinance, but there's another ordinance that we're shaping, that we're considering regarding public shade trees that is coming down the pike, and to let the council know that. And Jesse did. He read my email to the council, which I was really pleased to see. And, you know, and he identified in his recent inaugurational, whatever, press discussion, his commitment to trees. So that's a good thing.
I wonder if that's, did he read that at the council meeting in December?
Yeah.
I wonder if that's the reason why the council didn't take up that ordinance. Council did not vote on that. They tabled it.
Yeah, they tabled it, and I don't know why. I could follow up as to why, but...
I could just go ask Pam.
Okay. Yeah, he did say that they did table it till 2016.
How often do they meet?
Twice.
Maybe it's because they wanted an ordinance to be considered by the new council. I mean, it could
it's
be...
It's possible.
Which would be a really reasonable thing. All right, so you'll follow up on that. I think I'm kind of done with my piece on that. And the last thing is that I did hear back from Schichtels. They sent the 2006, Schichtels is the tree nursery in upstate New York that's got a lot of bare root stock. They sent us their bare root tree list for 2016, which I forwarded to Rich, Jay, and Rob, I think, and Jen too. If anyone else wants to see it, I'm happy to forward it to you too. They told us their minimum order was 25.
25 trees?
Yep, which seems really reasonable. So I'd love to hear from you guys whether you're satisfied with the tree list, whether it's you know, something you feel like you can work with. That's it for my chair report. Tree warden report.
So a couple of items. Tree City USA has been completed. Fully, which is good. I just wanted to give you so last year we spent about $312,000 altogether on community forestry expenditures, and that's an increase from last year because that also includes all the volunteer time that we did for planting all the trees. So the volunteer time was about 25,000 of that piece.
Can you describe what you mean by that, volunteer time? Do you mean time that your staff volunteered or that you quantified?
We quantified the volunteers that actually planted trees, starting with, and do we quantify the Public Shade Tree Commission's time?
Mm-hmm.
We did not, so we just quantified the time that we started out by planting the first when we had the actual training at Bridger Cemetery, and we just kind of moved it forward. Based on the number, I think we did an average of 25 people per Saturday, multiplied by the rate that is set by this federal mm-hmm. government, and that's what it came out to be. So we spent roughly tree planting and initial care of 37,000. Tree maintenance was 118,000. Tree removals was 58,000, which is down from the previous year, which is good. Management, 72,000. And volunteer time was 25,000.
Would you?
Include our 45 for the floor?
No.
Can you?
I can make copies.
Or just pass it around with people.
I'd love to just have an electronic version of that.
You won't be able to get an electronic version.
Okay.
Buried in the Chief City USA website. You can't make a PDF out of it for some reason. I tried.
I see.
So okay. I can actually make copies of this.
Well, I just think it's important press and council information that we leverage $25,000 in volunteer time. That's.
Sure. So our per capita expenditures were $10.38, and the minimum is $2. So that's up from last year as well.
The minimum, or the tree.
Mm-hmm. Tree City USA, yeah.
Do you have that going back a while?
Tree City USA.
You know, the dollar amount, how the trends?
Yes, I would have to go through the web portal to get all that information. For some reason, you don't get a hard copy.
Might be worth going back 5 years because it's probably going to see a pretty steep climb.
Well, there was a few years that unfortunately that there was no tree warden, and I think we actually ended up skipping. We ended up losing a couple of years, but we've been at Tree City USA. This will be 9 years running.
9 years in a row?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. I mean, that from the press angle, I think going back, you know, 2, 3, or whatever, just to show.
Well, I would actually be a little bit more careful about saying that we spend $10.38 per capita, just because the anti-tax people might see that as a gross increase in our spending on trees, whereas the leveraging part feels like it's a little bit more of a, everybody loves that. We did have a significant number of people who filled out our survey just to iterate that they hate taxes.
Taxes or spending tax money on trees?
Both, really. I mean, it was pretty universal.
So the subset that
chose to talk about it.
Yeah.
Anything else on your end, Rob? I mean, Rich?
I don't know. Just asking Rich, tree planting, initial care is like going back and staking them in general.
Initial care is actually the planting, watering, staking, right. Just the action that we did by planting them.
So the watering from the previous year, watering the previous year's trees would also be.
Yes, and we factor that in there. So we did once a week for the whole growing season.
Right.
With the amount of time that the employees spent doing the work.
Right.
And I assume that these maintenance and management figures involve a lot of heavy machinery and, you know. The,
yep.
Yeah.
Yep, they involve heavy machinery, my salary, the tree crew salary. Okay. Do we have engineering salary?
No.
No. Engineering has a little piece of it as well, which was not added into that.
And part of your salary, so what are you estimating for your hours per week spent on trees?
Well, I use my stipend, so I get a stipend of $5,000, but that's not a real number because I spend a lot more time. I spend probably about 40% of my time.
Trees?
Yeah. Probably almost 40%.
Wow, really, Rich? Yeah. That is, from our perspective, that's really great to hear. Do you feel like that's sustainable?
Given my personality, yes. Given someone else's personality, maybe not. But yes, I do feel sustainable.
Okay.
Plus, I have good staff that makes it a lot easier. Makes a big difference. Thank Terry. She's always keeping me on the straight and narrow, that's for sure.
Speaking of staff, do you know how the new downtown focused maintenance person is going to mesh into the tree world?
No, that person is not going to work for the Department of Public Works, it's going to work for the Parking Commission.
Really?
Yeah. I'm not sure. He's going to be working with probably Brian Mazeski and Mike Dean, so probably working for David Pomerantz or something. that's where the maintenance comes out. I don't think it's really going to affect anything at this point. I'm assuming that Tom Motor applied for the job. He was with some gentleman who's done it all the years, pretty with somebody else's. He doesn't do anything with trees, obviously. He's pretty stupid to rules. But we have someone new that's going to require some communication, so. So the other two other pieces I have is one is the revolving fund that we were requesting from DOR has been denied because of the fact that it is a revenue. We are actually putting revenue in a revolving fund and it is not approved by DOR.
Was that $700?
No, it was like, well, no, that was 10, it's like 12,000. So because it's fine driven, so part of it's fine driven, part of it's mitigation driven. It's still a revenue fund. You can't put revenue into a revolving fund.
So it just goes in the general fund?
For the moment, it's going to go in. It's going to go into the general fund. We have a tracking mechanism to track it.
Is there a commitment in the city to reserve that money for
you? Yes. What we're going to, what Susan Wright is looking into, I had a conversation with her today, is actually making what they call a receipt reserve fund, which is a fund that is monies can be put into there and then you roll over year to year. They can be designated for city street trees. The only issue is that an order will have to come from the mayor's office to the council to release the money every time we want to spend it. But it's the easiest and cleanest way to actually make sure the money doesn't get swallowed up in the general fund, because if not, you have to, so after free cash gets certified, which usually happens in November, city council is allowed to spend money on the mayor's request out of the free cash account and put money back into the city budget. So technically, every year we can say, okay, we put in $10,000 in the general fund for this line item. We can track it on a spreadsheet. We would go to the city council. The mayor would go to the city council and ask them to put the money back in the DPW budget. If we fail to expend that money by the end of the fiscal year, which is June 30th, that money automatically, whatever is left over, we can't encumber it. It goes back to the general fund. So you have to track it again. So it creates a long, so if you don't spend it, you're in trouble. So it creates a long issue. So we potentially could lose that money. So Susan's thoughts are is to see if we can do a receipt reserve fund and actually just deposit the money in that account and then take that money out when we need it, and it'll be strictly used for trees only. So it's similar to that gift account that Andrew was speaking of for $700, but it's a different fund. And it'd be rolled over and we would never lose it, so.
Curious, I mean, have we talked to Amherst about how they make, because they're facing the same thing, right?
No, I haven't talked to them.
Would it be worth one of us to reach out?
Sure.
Okay, does anyone around the table want to do that?
I can, I'm gonna see Ellen next week so I can ask them.
Okay.
And the other, anybody have any questions about that?
The account that you're trying to develop would not need city council approval?
No, the account that we are trying to receive reserve fund would require city council to transfer the money out.
And mayor approval?
The order has to come from the mayor's office.
Okay.
The problem is that if we let it languish in a general fund and we get a different administration, they can take that general fund money because it is a fine. So all fines go to the general fund, NGO. And a different administration may change their mind and take the money and do something else with it. So this is why I think it'd be important to set up this account so we can actually deposit the money in this. So the deposit part can happen very easily. We just put the account numbers down and they actually put it on. They put it on a warrant. What do they call that?
I have a question, but
yeah, go ahead.
Right,
any questions?
So I just want to say what we do in Hadley. So this commission, the city or town of Hadley could say, okay, you're allowed to have $10,000 into your funds every year, but anything over that would go to the general fund. And then at the end of the year, the mayor would go, oh, it was $3,000. Just say, for example, can we just give them back to $3,000? So you can always, you can write the ordinance or whatever it may be, to always allow you, this commission, to have a certain amount of funds under trees without having you constantly go back every year to get it out of your fund. you know, we just like roll, so you're, they can say that 10,000 or 20,000, they can set the limit, and so you're free to spend it without having to answer to anybody. But per se, just say if it was like 3,000 over at the end of the year, then they would take the 3,000, then the mayor would say, okay, can we give them the $3,000 back?
Well, we don't have the right to spend any money as a commission.
Correct. Actually, so, Susan Wright just sent me an email. They had to create an account. It says, from Joyce Garpinski, for your request, the following account was created, 1004-432023, fees-tree warden. So Susan is directing me to put all the monies into that account. So I'm assuming that it was a receipt reserve fund, receipt reserve account. So I will follow up with you, but I think that's probably what we're going to have to do.
And just a question, not all of the revenue is generated through fees. It would be generated through permitting too.
It is, and that goes into
the, and that's the same thing. That is, that that's also considered sort of commensurate to fees.
Yep. So anything that goes into the general fund, and then whatever administration we have can decide how they're going to divide up that general fund money once it's been certified. So if we have an administration that chooses not to fund, let's say we have a line item that we're relying upon every year in the DPW budget for tree maintenance for $10,000. If the administration decides that they're not going to use that fee money or that violation money that we have collected, and they're going to use it to support some other part of the budget, they could do that. I mean, we would be out of luck. With this account, at least the money will be in there, and it's under the control of the council. The mayor can't, and the mayor cannot take the money out. The council has to approve it by unanimous vote to remove it.
Unanimous vote?
Not unanimous, two-thirds, I'm sorry.
Okay.
So once the money's in there, then it's basically protected by the councilors, in a sense, from the any administration taking the money out.
So you don't have to ask every year, at the end of the year, to get it back?
No.
It doesn't go into the room?
No, because there'll be no money left. So you basically take the money off for things that you want to do. So say we want to buy $10,000 for the trees, we go and we ask the city council to release $10,000 out of the account, we code the invoice to that account, and that's it, the bill's paid.
And you can have that. You can have the surplus sit there from year to
correct.
Year.
Correct. It just rolls over, and it'll just, you can just keep adding to it. If you don't spend it for 2 or 3 years, it just keeps growing.
Okay.
Before I even collect, you know, revenue through mitigation or through fees.
And how is this different than if people want to make donations for a tree planting fund? Could that be separate?
Don't really answer that question. I imagine it can be because we have a gift account. That's what that gift account is set up for. So people used to give money, and they would put the money in the gift account, and it's just like this. It's the same thing. The city council has control over the funds. As long as DOR is okay with the account, then the funds are taken out as what are requested.
Okay, well, I think just since Amherst also, you know, follows the same DOR regulations, that we just check in with them. Okay. They've been at this a little bit.
So the other item on my quick agenda, longer than I thought agenda, is the folks at 623 Kennedy Road. I met with them on the 28th of December and identified, if you remember, these are the folks that actually applied for a driveway permit after the planning board approved their change in their driveway to have a new driveway, which is going to require 8 public shade trees to be removed for a total of 55 and a half DBH. So I'm actually in the process of putting this all together for them and actually sending them an email and trying to work with them to mitigate the loss of these trees so they can actually move ahead and get their driveway squared away in the spring. Because it's a real, it's a hazard for them trying to get out of their driveway. It's very dangerous. So that basically amounts to about $5,000 worth of mitigation funds. And then of course I have to tack on how much it's gonna cost to remove the trees. And then the rest have to run the public shade tree ad, so I have to do the mathematics for the actual work. But they're not.
So that still has to go through a shade tree here?
Yes. Yep, and I explained to them the process. I think they were a little stunned. I think this is one of the reasons why we have this issue. The planning board approves things, and then they approve it, and they just say, just go see the DPW to get the trees cut down. And the planning board doesn't explain to them what the process is. So. It was good to meet with them. I think they were a little frustrated, but
just yes. What do you think about the numbers? Though? Tree removal is not cheap. Putting a new driveway is not cheap. So, I mean, it's kind of comparable. It's not like the most expensive part of the whole project, you know. The fees are, it's probably something they're banking on, but putting the new driveway is not expensive either.
No, and their driveway is changing from a short one to a very long one. It's meandering, it's gonna require a lot of fill.
So, I mean, when you think about the numbers, it's a percentage of the overall project.
It is, but unfortunately for them, when they went to the planning board, they had, you know, they had their proposals. They had a set, they had their fee basically, what it was gonna cost. Now, they get...
It's a surprise for them.
$5,000 plus.
Yeah.
$5,000 plus the tree removals. Now, if they weren't public shade trees, they still have to do, they're still gonna have to do their own removals because they have other trees that are private that they own that are larger, that are in the way, that they're gonna have to have removed. So they are, it's gonna cost them a lot of money to do this. It's not gonna be cheap. But, you know, it's something they're wanting to do, you know. The mitigation, the lady was like, why can't you just cut the trees down? I said, because you can't, they're protected. And I said, that's where we get involved. And I apologize for the lack of communication, told her we're trying to correct it. So since then, I've communicated with Sarah LaValle before, we have any more of these issues that I get heads up before.
Absolutely.
The planning board approves any type of site plans.
Well, I think that touches on some of Todd's proposals, so.
So those are the three items that I have.
Great. Okay.
And I'll get back with them and I'll have a report for you the next meeting that system if we can do well.
Thanks. All right, officer elections is next on the agenda. And Todd very kindly emailed me that perhaps it's not legal to accept nominations by email. So I'm just gonna start from scratch here and just say, are there any nominations for both chair and vice chair of the tree commission?
Nominate Lily for chair. I nominate, second that, and nominate Todd to be the vice chair.
Second.
Okay, any other nominations?
No, if you would want to be chair, Jay, I mean, I think you know a lot about trees. I mean, I don't know if you want to, you know.
I'd rather not.
Yeah.
At this time, at least.
Okay, any other nominations? All right, discussion?
Well, I'd just like to say that I think Lily and Peter puts in a lot of time. Todd puts in some time too. And I appreciate the amount of time, not just the quality, I mean, also the quality of work, but I think it's fitting for the chair, to be a chair if you're going to put in.
And the meeting management is next.
Yeah, meeting management, whatever. Time outside the meeting is what I'm really referring to. Because, I mean, we're all here at the meeting.
Okay. I appreciate everything you've done as chair, what you're contributing as vice chair, Todd. And you've accomplished a lot in half a year, and just to keep that momentum going, I'd say let's keep you as chair and vice chair.
Are we clear on how long we are, how long this appointment, not appointment, officer position would last? Is this for 1 year, 1 calendar year? We decided we were going to do it every January?
Yeah, we don't have bylaws, but I think that's good practice to do it for a year.
Okay, all right.
It makes more sense.
Okay, then. All right, so
we're doing January to December.
We're doing January 1st to December 31st, essentially. Okay, so we have a motion and a second for the nominations of both myself for chair and Todd as vice chair. And any further discussion? Okay, let's separate them out. I think, or does that make sense? Or should we just do it as a, what do you call it?
Do it as a package.
A package deal?
Do this package, because that's how it's done.
Usually done, okay. All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Nays? Abstain? Okay, one abstention? All right, that takes care of that. Thanks, everybody. I'm happy to carry on in these early years with the sort of leadership here, and I will do my best to be responsive to everybody's style and contributions. Always happy to learn from other people. Always happy to hear feedback. Constructive is the most helpful. and I am hoping that this, you know, will eventually lead to a leadership change, and doesn't need, you know, I know we talked about potentially vice chair moving into a chair position. I don't know that we have had a serious discussion of that, or if Todd has decided that that's something he's comfortable with, but you know, this is not something that I want to stay in permanently, because I think it's really good to share roles and just to let other people lead, experience other people's styles. Okay. All right, so we were going to talk about the survey summary. We're going to bump that back so that we can answer the question, or at least explore the question, what is our work, and does it include volunteer organizing? And I think this is a question that came both from Rob and Jen, and so I might ask you guys to lead that conversation.
Okay.
Or at least to explain why you feel it's an important question to ask.
No. I think that the volunteer part of this has been really fun for me, and it's quite a bit of work. But right at the very beginning, when I set out to do it, I felt a little uncomfortable saying as to how to identify the volunteer organization. Are people volunteering with the Public Shade Tree Commission? Because I've had a volunteer organization before. There was some confusion as to that. And when I would say it's the Public Shade Tree Commission, it seemed almost ambiguous as to whether the Public Shade Tree Commission was, in fact, the organizing body behind the volunteer effort, in terms of whether they really saw that as part of their role, the commissioner. I think Todd pointed out that it's not usual for a commission necessarily to run a volunteer organization.
It's not usual for most governmental bodies, maybe right. Not a commission.
Okay, so, that's great. And I think that there is the real possibility and opportunity for the volunteer effort to go on as a separate entity, not being part of the Public Safety Commission. You know, I don't think that it necessarily has to be. On the other hand, a lot of good effort was drawn from the people in the room here. So by being with part of the Public Safety Commission, maybe we get a boost of interest. There's been a lot of volunteers. So I think having it be really clear, though, would be good, because when we send out emails, print things that we hang on doors, go around with little pennies on, whatever we do, it'd be really good to be able to say the Public Shade Tree Commission is asking you to volunteer, the Public Shade Tree Commission. And I know that when we discussed this before, I think it was Lily suggesting that we just say the city of Northampton was asking. That was one of your suggestions, I think. When I was asking who are people volunteering for? They're volunteering for the city of Northampton, which is also good and true, but leaves it a little vague in terms of people we all sort of pinpoint where the effort's coming from. So I think it's more than just semantics, though. I think that as a group, it would be good to have the whole group at least take some time to think about how we're running the volunteer organization. I have to say there's like a flip side to that. When Todd starts writing the ordinances, I don't probably pay as much attention to it as I do the volunteer part. So in some ways, having people break off and look into a particular bailiwick, kind of take care of a particular bailiwick, it's kind of a natural phenomenon. So, but that said, and just the same, I think it would be good to have a little bit greater determination from this group to be a little bit more cognizant and thoughtful of the moving ahead with the volunteer organization, or have the organization moved to the side where a different group is looking after it. You know, a board, if you will. I mean, we don't have a formal board, but some kind of group that's responsible. I do like being out there a little bit on my own. Some, I'm not a complaint, but it's probably a little bit not quite right. I think Lily's idea of getting it all on Google Docs so that we can at least not be dependent on what's in Jen's and my memories is a good idea. But it still probably doesn't spread information and the knowledge out far enough.
I kind of see, I mean, Rob and I worked together, but certainly Rob did the more of the kind of email management, database management. And as we kept going and get more volunteers, I was like, whoa, you know? I mean, when I first said, yeah, I'll volunteer to head up a tree planting, like I didn't get it, that it was gonna be this endless thing, you know? And I like, you know, being part of, you know, the organization and stuff like that, but to me, it's a huge job. And a big chunk of it is database management, which I stink at. You know, that is not the computer end of things is not my strength. And I'll put that out there, you know. So, you know, my worry is that we've developed this interest and kind of things are moving forward. There's a lot of positive feelings in the community. And my experience working with volunteers, if you drop the ball too long, then you lose people or people get kind of mad, or, you know, I just think if we're going to commit to an ongoing volunteer organization, we got to have like some, I would feel more comfortable having some more buttoned up organizational system to contact people, to, you know, what are we doing, what, you know, it's kind of universal, I don't know what you want, you know, letterhead or whatever. It's got to be like, this is what, or our emails always look the same or something, you know, so it's, you know.
Establishment of an identity.
Exactly. Yeah, kind of what you were saying, but more like the amount of work is more than I, with my full-time job, that I can really do. So my thought was, oh, do we need to, write a grant for a part-time volunteer organizer, or, you know, get friends of the tree committee? I mean, I don't know what the answer is, but it's, and I would like to continue, you know, I'm happy to go hang door hangers. I'm happy to, you know, do all kinds of footwork, plant trees, run a group, do a training if we need, you know, I'm like happy to do all that kind of stuff, but kind of the background holding that organization, I probably can't.
Sustain what you do.
Yeah, I can't. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't know, maybe Rob can't, but I can't. I can tell you that much. And I'm still like, I haven't done it, you know, finished what I was supposed to be doing, so.
I just wanted to ask a couple of questions. First of all, how many of us, just show of hands, stepped into this commission thinking that that was going to be part of the whole thing, organizing volunteers to plant trees or to help whatever, take care of trees?
I thought it might be something with volunteers.
A percentage.
Okay. Is that, did anyone not think that that was going to be part of it? I'm just curious. And that's not pinning anything on us. I'm just curious.
I mean, I'd probably put myself in that camp, mostly because I think I suspected how, or maybe feared, but I think suspected how much volunteer coordination can suck up, you know, meeting time, right. Then right. Commissioner time outside of, so, you know, knowing that that's over, you know, is really not terribly sustainable in the long term without some sort of expansion, probably made it so that I did not think that was going to happen too much.
Yeah, when it comes to like tree care, I think basically just the outreach component would be, from my perspective, from what I understood, would be locations, yes, in my front yard, and also getting people to sign on to watering at a basic level of outreach to say, hey, you have this tree, you want to water it, because that's an outreach. My concern is that it's a lot of work, you know, that it's more than people who volunteer can actually do and do well. Obviously, you guys did a great job, but obviously there's like a breaking point where you can't continue just to keep taking that task on. So I think it is, from my understanding, it is a part of this commission's ability to add value to the community, but at a certain point, there has to be a clear understanding of how far you can go within your
It might, time. It might be worth just creating a list of things that either have already been involving volunteers or that we anticipate, just to kind of get a sense of what does it mean to include or respond to volunteer interests or requests? Just so that we know what we're talking about, because volunteers is...
Well, connecting what Andrew and you have just said is that it's partly just sitting here looking for a group to work on this, is that it could easily expand from here, but it doesn't have to expand necessarily. And if it were to expand, it would be quite a big thing. I mean, we had about 80 people involved so far. We've got another 50 who have said that they would like to be involved, maybe. So, you know, I actually don't feel that doing what we did last year would be that taxing, because we invented the whole thing within months and then did. If I think our goal, if we decided as a group, okay, well, that was a good thing. We want to just repeat that. That seems fairly doable to me. Expanding on it then would take more management resources than I alone and Jen can do. I mean, you know, a lot of what Jen, you're referring to doing database, writing up that first document, that we don't have to do all over again.
Right.
If we have the program sort of maintain itself in a similar fashion, where it's so many Saturdays format. Because there was a lot of work getting the format together.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Jay, you want to say something?
Yeah, I was just, you know, we kind of got into it in a big way, partly because of your interest in it.
Yeah.
Why not look for people within the volunteer group to help you organize the volunteer group? And you could be like the liaison between that group and this group.
I think if the Public Safety Commission thought it was a good idea, including you, that's kind of, I'm already touching on that. I sent out an email to all the people who said that they would be willing to volunteer in the future, looking for those from that, people that would actually work with me that I could help organize so that I could start dividing up my work.
I'm sure there are people in that could help with the organization.
Right. Yeah.
So related to that, my next question was going to be, what are the advantages of having this commission have control of the volunteer organizing aspect of tree work?
Well, first of all, it seems like a good problem if we have a lot of people who are interested in this. And because the opposite would be there's not much interest in it. So anyway, I just want to say, I think this is a good problem to have if we have a lot of people. Now, how do we manage it? And perhaps what you mentioned, Jay, is a good model. So instead of us taking on this growing role of volunteer coordination, have somebody in that group or a bunch of people in that group manage the group but have somebody on this committee as that point person, liaison between the two groups. So if,
right.
it's just say
yes.
if it was you, then you
could so
get a report from the group and then report back to the group from us.
Right, so as I fully and more fully digest the survey, which you supplied the part about volunteers and also the part about people that have requested trees, it gives me the opportunity to meet people and then to ask them.
Yeah.
And that's really what I mean, it's partly why I wanted to have this discussion now, was that I'd like to be able to go out and say to people, oh, the Public Safety Commission is going to be running this group, and, or the, you know, is kind of running, is asking that there be a volunteer group that they are sanctioning in some way, and do you want to be part of it by working, it's ongoing, you know, do you want to like get involved, work with me on this? And I mean, it seems maybe it's a question that doesn't need to be asked, it seems sort of maybe obvious that, oh yeah, we're going to have a volunteer group that is ongoing. But it's still worth pausing and stopping, because now is when, yeah, I'd like to find people who actually want to perhaps even come to our meetings, begin to understand, so they don't have to be commissioners and work with us. I hope I can find such people.
So is there anyone around this table who feels that this commission needs to maintain control of that volunteer organizing aspect? Well, I'll just start with that. Does anyone feel like that is a really core part of our work, to hold on to the organizing of volunteers?
I think there should be a nonprofit that does the work, but I don't see one. You know, I think in my ideal world, there would be something like we were in Springfield that was just there, that was already doing that work. So I think, from my perspective, it would be nice if we could use this as an opportunity to generate enthusiasm for forming a nonprofit.
And a nonprofit doesn't have to be a 501c3. I mean, you kind of already have a nonprofit, right?
Right. Yes.
Okay.
Right. So it's not tax deductible, but I do have a bank account and a DBA.
Well,
and all that stuff.
The thing is, you're organizing volunteers. I'm not actually sure how much money that needs to involve. Like the tree stock, the all of the other pieces could come from the city, but the city could partner with this group. So back to my question, does anyone object to that whole concept? I mean, Jay proposed it. You suggest that we don't really have the sustainability. So, okay. And then I'd like to hear from Rich, because this obviously impacts your vision. And
I'm just going, before you comment on it, I'm just thinking, I don't think we want just to let a volunteer group go loose in the city without supervision.
Right.
Definitely not.
Well, yeah, I mean, they can't actually do anything without Rich. But they can just go, instead of being involved with the commission, it's really a question, being involved with the commission or just go to Rich and say, Rich, we want to plant these trees. And in other words, the commission doesn't have to be in between the volunteers.
But I think they can be a buffer between the volunteer group and Rich.
Yeah. I think
so.
Yeah,
Rich doesn't have.
Yeah, we're coordinating.
But you can see Rich thinking.
I think it's essential that the commission is in there somewhere. I mean, I don't think the commission has to run the volunteers, but I see a problem. You know, if there's, you know, we've got a lot of knowledge around this table, and you know, we're doing all this research and stuff like that, and we have like long-term vision here. So we're going to do this tree inventory, and then, you know, so they could like be out there doing their own thing and not be privy or not agree to follow the program.
So
you know, we're trying to set up a long-term sustainable program, and that piece I don't think we should let go of.
I think it would be good to have the group report to a commissioner or report to two commissioners.
Yeah.
So that there is always a communication level between the commission, the tree warden, and the volunteer group. Mm-hmm. Because I will use, what is Felix's group?
Right, exactly. Felix Lufkin, Help Yourself.
Help Yourself. So
yeah.
What happened there is that, it's just one example I can think of, is that there's public properties over here that are really maintained by the Parking Commission, but deeded to the Recreation Commission, that Wayne Fiden said that Felix's folks could plant trees. And so next thing you know, there's trees in all these places, and now Brian, the parking commission, is like, well, I don't know where I'm gonna put my snow now, or I think I just mowed over three trees because no one told me that the trees were there. Those are the kind of things that I want to avoid, so we need to have some kind of a chain of command.
Right, and by the way, Felix is coming to a February meeting, he's just out of the country right now.
Which will be good, because it's been kind of, you know, and all of a sudden, trees would show up on the Northampton bikeway, which is the one that runs from Stoddard Street out of nowhere, and the guy from the Parks Cemetery Department at DPW maintains where these trees come from, so I have no idea.
Yeah.
So I have to track down Wayne, so it creates this, a real kind of situation that you don't want to fall into, so I think that I actually kind of envision having a couple of different arms coming from this commission. One of them is a group of folks that is dedicated to planting, and another group of folks is actually dedicated and trained in doing tree inventory, and another group of folks is dedicated in doing tree pruning. All different facets of things that we all have interest in, but not, you know, watering is another one, but not tying all the commissioners up every weekend for X amount of time to actually being out there and doing the work. Having these groups be formed and having them responsible to one commissioner, and that commissioner creating coordination between the commission and the individual, the tree warden. Because that really, everything that happens outside of the commission with these different bodies is gonna really impact what I do and how I manage my staff every day, because we are gonna have to support each one of these groups in a certain way, whether it's from simply ordering water bags and then just handing them out and never seeing them again, but still producing lists, telling people where to go, you know, there's a lot of different pieces. But I can see also that the roles of the commissioners really are more, I mean, we have a lot of roles, we've taken on a lot this year, and there's a lot of different things that we all would like to do, and the volunteer piece of it, I think I felt that we would have more volunteers doing different things. I just wasn't sure exactly what they were gonna do. And, you know, we had this pot of money and we have Rob as a commissioner, and, you know, his forte is getting trees in the ground.
Thank you, Public Shade Tree Commission.
Thanks, Rob.
So.
Seems like communication is.
I think communication is, communication is key.
So we don't lose anybody.
Yeah.
The thing about Reed and Springfield, what they have is their kind of ace in the hole is Dave Donyar is like their main guy, so he knows their forestry in and out. So if like if a nonprofit does ever show up, it might be beneficial to consider like making sure that one of the members of the board of directors is a member of this commission somehow. There might be some way to structure it so that there's like a natural built-in like synergy, I hate to use that word. Like, So that way it wouldn't be operating in isolation, and that would be real.
Well, we told them it's illegal.
Oh, really?
No, I don't think it is.
No, I thought the attorney said, when he mentioned the friends, he said we couldn't be on it.
Oh, well.
But maybe
once a month, a volunteer can report back to us, like as like a regular item on our agenda. If the volunteer group gets organized enough, there can be a...
Yeah, I do think it has to become more than, you know, one-man show, and somehow a structure has to be nurtured and created that, you know, allows for sustainable, you know, growth over time, as opposed to, you know, you doing everything and, you know, you jumping in and helping, you know, but that's great, but at some point that's not.
And we don't have to figure that out now.
Right.
So I just want to say to the question, does our commission work include volunteer organizing? Seems to me like the answer is not necessarily, does not necessarily include volunteer organizing. But we could envision a situation where one or more volunteer groups that want to work on trees report to one or two commissioners, so there is always really clear communication between us, our tree warden, the larger vision of, you know, our mission and vision, and the actual hands on the ground, feet on the ground work. Is that right? Well, we did go into that thinking that, but here we are a year, you know, 9 months, 10 months later going, but is it really our work? And I think I just heard folks say that what they wanted was to feed that off to a nonprofit entity and have them really work with us, but not necessarily that be the work we do around this table twice a month.
Can we compare this to Amherst, just quickly review, even though we're recently, I think that they are the commission, they're, right, there's something else, committee, what are they?
They're the same thing.
They're the same thing.
They're the same thing.
Okay, they're advisory, okay, well, they somehow, they do take that as a major part of the task.
They do, it's just true.
The whole volunteer thing, they're as a group.
How are they doing?
How are they doing? I mean, they're impressive in their accomplishments.
They have attrition on their committee.
Yeah.
I remember, do you remember the one we went to? They were like, we can't find more people to join this committee.
No.
They have attrition on the committee, their work is impressive, they've done it for years, so they've got some routines that they, you know, they do a planting, Saturday planting, they do this neighborhood planting once or twice a year, the Saturday plantings are once a month.
They don't plant any more trees with volunteers than we do, probably.
Well, I mean, we've done it once, they've been doing this for years.
They're doing it for a long time, but I mean, the scale.
So, absolutely, they have decided as a group that that's a core part of their work, is volunteering.
Right.
A volunteer coordinator.
So perhaps instead of, again, like us take, somebody on this commission being a volunteer coordinator, somebody on this commission or a couple of people could be volunteer liaison to a group that is sort of self-organizing. Well, not just like organically, but I mean, we could simply ask that pool of volunteers that exists to date, are there at least a handful of people who would like to take charge? And
there aren't, but I mean, that's part of the way that we're asking, then we're asking the question of is that I think it's time to find that, if possible, a handful of people. And it would be easier to go find a handful of people if we were a little more clear
what we're asking.
Exactly who we're asking. You know, what we're asking for. And are we asking them to be an independent group, or are we asking them to essentially report to me and Jen so that we can then report to you? You know, we're just trying to figure out what we're asking people to do and what we should be doing.
I agree with that. I also think it would be easier to find people if there was an event, you know, but I don't know. I mean, that takes time and organization, but to have some kind of like, I don't know, need creator. I don't know what you'd call it.
Well, we have a lot of people. But do we want to be finding more people?
No. I mean, to get, it's so easy to get an email and be like, I don't want to do that. Versus like, now you could go out and meet them face to face, everyone.
But,
you know, I don't know how, if, I mean, you may be able to do that, you know, but I'm just trying to like get efficiency trying to get a group of people together and say, people are in the room, and then maybe somebody does say, this is pretty cool, all right, I'll do that, you know? I mean, that's just my experience.
We have to do something. And what I was going to do is take the list of people who said they might help, and instead of sending out a mass email to them, often they have issues they'd like addressed, and say, look, people concerned about how many trees are planted in Ward 3, there are several of them. Say, look, if you guys want to like look after Ward 3, join this volunteer group, help us, you know, move forward. So sort of an individual response to people's questions.
Maybe it would be helpful if, like, you know, Rich mentioned three things, pruning, planting, and assisting with inventory. If we come up with a list of, you know, a handful of things, these are things that we need help with. Because just to ask somebody to volunteer, they'd be like, well, what for what?
Just be able to sort them into those piles.
I would agree.
We could have like precinct captains or
because people join organizations to do things.
Yeah.
People just don't join organizations just to say, I joined an organization, they're actually there because they want to do something.
Right.
And then the other thing, to kind of zooming back out a little bit, is the inventory. Once the inventory is completed, we're going to have a better sense of exactly what work we need to do in our urban canopy. And I think that'll also maybe help guide the commission a little more as to what their goals are. You know, what's your goals, you know, your short-term goals, and what your long-term goals are. Mm-hmm. And I think this is one of the pieces that'll fit into that, because part of that is the identifying the planting sites. So if you have all that, if you're armed with that information, you have 1,000 sites you're gonna plant, you're gonna say, okay, our goal is to knock off 250 sites this year, and we need X amount of volunteers, and this is how we're gonna go about it, going about to get them. But I think to, I think it's going to, that's a really important piece. We really have to find a way to get that done. If we don't get the grant money, we have to, we're going to have to really go and, you know, I don't think we have to put the mayor's arm behind his back, because I think he's pretty well said that he would find a way to do it. But I think it's really important, because it really, I think, will shape or may move this commission in a different, just a little different direction, because you'll have a like a blueprint to work on, per se.
Okay, so I'm going to just try to find closure to this, because we've hit our time for the amount of time we're going to discuss this. So I still don't think at the end of this discussion we're clear if this is a core piece of our work, the volunteer organizing. But I think that I've heard that everyone is open to the concept of having Rob, for example, who we trust, and you know, he's a proven volunteer coordinator, and he already has contacts with lots of volunteers over several years, not just last fall, to start sort of self-organizing. But he's not going off in some rogue fashion. He's going to be reporting back to our commission, and what it's going to do is it's going to position us to have volunteers lined up, and maybe even some co-leaders, or maybe that's one way you could spend some of that time with that long list of potential volunteers, is identifying who could take up a leadership role,
right,
with you.
That's
and it may be some people around this table. I mean, you know, that's not excluded. So I think that we maybe don't need to rule out one or the other at this stage, but that we feel comfortable with the idea of another group self-organizing to bring volunteers forward when we need them. But it would always be, you know, in coordination with us in the city for whatever our planting or watering.
It would have to be, because really the volunteers can't do anything. They're not allowed to dig a hole or...
Yeah, you know, of course.
I think the coordination issue is not something that would, I guess, good point Felix's group did seem to get away with that, so it's possible, I guess.
It was the years when there was no treatment.
I don't think it's going to get away. I think it's just really a matter of where people want to put their energy, and so I think I will proceed with getting some volunteers who maybe will have their own ideas eventually as to whether they want to have a separate organization or just essentially work with me, Jen, and continue to volunteer. I think, though, that if we're going to plant in the spring or fall, you know, sometimes we have to go with what we have, and that was part of my hesitation about rocking the boat too much in terms of like suddenly trying to organize to do huge amount of bare root, because you know, so it's a relative weakness of the organization. You can't be organized to like suddenly have planted 100 bare root trees this week at any time.
Okay, I feel like that's a little bit getting ahead of ourselves. I want to just make sure that we wrap this up. If you want to discuss spring planting or fall planting, I can put it on the agenda for the next.
I'm going ahead.
Yeah. Okay. Go ahead.
I feel I can go ahead here. I've got a sense of things.
All right.
I'm just thinking here to contact Dave Bloniars and Brian Kane and Rick Harper. They're over at UMass. And see if they could be a resource for us too. Because David's done a lot of organizing with volunteer groups. He might have some good ideas and be willing to come and work with us together.
That would be great. I mean, that would be using the Patriots mentioned today. Yeah. Invite them to come and talk to us about how they think we should do this.
Okay. So, Jay, you're going to contact? Okay, great. Okay. See you, Jen.
All right. Thanks.
All right, Marilyn.
All right. I'm still working on the report for the survey, so my revised timeline is to have a preliminary report for the next meeting and a final report by the first meeting in February. One thing that I did do was provide Rob and Jen a list of all the people who expressed interest in volunteering or being involved. which took a chunk of time because that was all from, a lot of that was from question 10, you know, to provide contact info, but it wasn't like a name in this box, an address. I mean, it was just all conglomerated, so I had to separate it all out into a spreadsheet. So anyway, I hope that that was helpful.
I have a spreadsheet.
Yeah.
It's great. It's helpful.
I mean, some had just first names, some had full names, some had just email addresses.
Some had
email addresses. A few said they'd like to volunteer or have a trade, but didn't get any notifying.
Yeah.
So anyway, it's coming. Sorry for the delay, but if anybody has any questions or
I have a question. Are you having to do this manually, like pick out each?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's worthwhile. I mean, yeah, it's worthwhile. Interest, I mean, but
yeah, because I mean, I want to systematically work through the list, and this helps me do it.
Yeah, it was all manual.
That's a lot of work.
Yeah. Thank you, Marilyn.
Okay.
So we'll look forward to. Did I send your preliminary report to everybody? I mean that. Did other people get? Do you know the thing that you sent me weeks ago, December 16th?
That was
December 16th,
yeah.
or November 12th?
No.
Here with the yellow for age group brackets.
Yeah.
Yeah. What I sent you was still that like kind of raw material.
Okay.
As
all
I'm
right.
sorting
all right. So not no need for me to forward that to.
No.
Okay. All right.
It's worth the time and effort just to sort of organize all the data because now I'm at the point where I can just start dumping it into a report. But it took a while just to take the raw material and then organizing it so that I understood what we had collected and start compiling. So. For Arbor Day, I volunteered last meeting to help coordinate it in the spring, and Rich and Jay expressed interest. So what I want to do with this time is just start crafting out our vision for that day, because we've obviously done things in the past which we can repeat and build upon, but I'm also wondering what else we might want to take on, and perhaps we could even draw on some of those volunteers if there's interest in helping the city with tree planting.
Well, actually, do you remember that there was a bullet that someone could identify in there, which was help for Arbor Day? This was in the survey.
Yeah.
So can you pull those people out?
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
So I've been to a handful of Arbor Days, helping, you know, volunteering.
Mm-hmm.
It is sometimes a little cold and windy, so out there standing around. And I don't like doing it, but it does cut down on the sort of eventness of it. People kind of whisk by, and so
depends on the
particular day and year. You know, so it could be that maybe having another kind of a, like even in something indoors or whatever, larger event, I don't know. I enjoy the ones we've had, they're good.
I had a lot of fun hanging trees out.
Yeah, exactly.
It was a good time.
It's good.
So we agree that we want to distribute trees again?
Awesome.
Do we get to select the type of tree they just send you?
No, they have I haven't got it yet. They will send me an email, or they send me the mail for the selections they have available. Wardens and Forest Association. It's kind of a good setup because all that money that's generated, other than to buy this bare root stock, is actually put into a scholarship fund for the Tree Warden and Forest Association. So we can buy, I think we bought 400 plants last year. We can buy more than that if you'd like.
Or if they raise $5,000 a year for scholarships.
Yeah, for students.
As I recall, though, we had. And this was 3 days of distribution. We had some left over.
Yep, we did.
So maybe 400 is.
400 is pretty. 400 is like the maximum amount we've given out.
Yeah.
You know, we did have leftovers. We planted a bunch.
Some popular speaking of those magnolias were going like hotcakes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It seems like any kind of, I mean, the lilacs were gone in a day.
Yeah.
So obviously we know that anything that is flowering, that has flowers, people are, you know, really like them a lot. People don't necessarily want to plant giant trees in their backyard.
Well, in my effort to get setback plantings, lilacs, dogwoods, crab apples, they're all the enemy, so I just wanted to throw that out there.
The enemy?
Right.
Well, people have a big, nice front yard and they put a, magnolia or a dogwood right in the middle out in front. And that's where there was a sugar maple. And then that's the end of the story.
Yeah, well, so a diversity of whips. I think you usually offer flowering and some bigger trees.
We try to add a conifer.
Yeah.
We try to put a conifer in there. I just drove down State Street actually, and there's two conifers. You see that corner tall, really? Somebody just cut them down today.
That was because they were diseased, right?
Was that the least Colorado blue spruce?
I think they were blue spruce.
Okay. So they had that registry.
State and true.
Yeah. Anyways, that's
a big path. When you find the list, will you run them by us?
Right, absolutely.
Thanks.
So I just looked at the spreadsheet, and 55 of the people who said that they would be interested in volunteering said they'd specifically be interested in Arbor Day.
Oh, really?
So yeah, 55
people. Yeah. Maybe one of the other things we could do, too, is we could think about maybe planting, if we have those kind of volunteers, and we could maybe plant one tree in each ward.
I would realistically divide that at least in half, if not by a third.
Right.
Filling out surveys is really different than showing
them. It's tiny, a number, but still 55 is a, you're going to get some.
Maybe.
But I guess what I'm saying is the events that we've had of standing there, we should think of a different format or an additional event or something, because I think we have more volunteers than we have an event that's calling for it. The one that Ridge has been running where two or three people behind the table handing out whips. I think there are a lot of people who want to do something, but I'm not sure what it is other than just that.
So as you're saying, it's diversified, try to do something different.
Yeah,
how many precincts are there in Northampton?
Seven.
Are there...
what if we handed out, we had a station in each of the seven?
Well, I have a question. There's some kind of farmer's market, even then, indoors, right, at the Voke School, is that?
That's all year, isn't it?
Yeah, it's all year.
No, it's not all year. It's not all year, and there's always a few weeks, and that might be one of them where there's no farmer's market, because there's no food yet.
No food, no farmer's market. Because, doing an event in a place like that would, people would be very...
I'm not sure. I suppose we can find out. I'm just... remembering also what the schedule is for bare root tree planting, because that might actually be precisely when bare roots should be in the ground. I think it's mid-April is when they deliver.
Depends, yeah.
And
depends on the year.
And so, that's one thing we could possibly try is a bare root planting with a bunch of volunteers where it wouldn't. It wouldn't be as strenuous for a lot of them.
Yeah, that'd be good.
If we could do 25, we could do the minimum order of 25.
Yeah, if we could
try it out.
If we could make it into a Arbor Day event, can you? Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly.
I think that would be nice.
But then a question is, we can't really make that decision until we know what the outcome of the grant is, right? Because we just don't know what the funds we have. Unless we want to try to draw from that 11,000.
I'm not worried about the money.
You're not worried about the money. I love it when you say that.
I've never worried about the money. There's always money to be had.
Okay.
Just gotta ask.
In the whole scope of things, it's if we get 25 trees, that's
Tyler, you see the headline tomorrow.
It's a couple thousand.
I also pretend you weren't fired.
It's very cheap.
No, it's free. Right, so it's very cheap. We're just talking about a few. $2,000-$3,000.
Yeah, no.
So,
I feel comfortable. We have, $12,000 in that account.
Yeah.
Plus, we'll have some more mitigation funds from the Kennedy Road. Plus, we have $37,000 in change in our account that we have presently for.
But that could all disappear to the survey.
All.
No?
No.
Okay. Good.
No, I don't think so, and I think that we could always ask for some more money if we need to from the mayor's office, and I think you would entertain it, so.
Yeah, it says that the Schichtel delivery is the last 2 weeks of April, so that's essentially
Arbor Day is the 29th.
So that would make Arbor Day a bigger event. We could get a little publicity maybe, I don't know.
So hand out whips as well as do some plantings.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I did notice things for the list, but did you look at the list? Did you get that list, the Schichtel list?
I did, yeah.
Quantities, although it seemed big, like something had 100 of this and 50 of that. Some of the trees will be gone.
Well, now, yeah, January is the time to put the order.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. It's like time to get to work on that, especially, you know.
Right.
I mean, if we wait until a couple months from now, a lot of it
will be
ordered by somebody else.
So what if folks like that idea, what quantity do we want to go for? We know that 25 is the minimum.
Are we wanting to do just a one-day event, do you think? Just that Friday?
Saturday?
Well,
is it Friday?
Or is it Friday the
24th? Friday. Yeah. Friday.
Because last year we had enough whips to hand out for 2 days.
Right.
Well, it's two different events. There's the
right. But what I'm saying is that do we want to concentrate? So does that mean we would lessen the amount of whips we're going to have, or we have the same amount of whips plus the 25 trees, and then we'll have to figure out how we're going to schedule each day? Are we going to plant the 25 trees on Friday? Are we going to just span the 2 days like we did last year?
I'm for fewer whips. You know, 1 day of handing out whips and then a day of planting, or it might be 2 days. And we have to plan for, and what if the weather's horrible and pouring, you know?
You don't have to order the whips for a long, long time, right? And I remember.
If you want to get what you want, you have to order them sometime over in March.
Okay, all right. So we can figure out that piece a little later. We know we want to do whips of some quantity, whether we distribute them 1 or 2 days.
Okay.
Maybe that's, that depends on how many volunteers come forward for helping out.
Yeah.
So distributing whips is one volunteer activity. Helping to plant bare root trees is another activity. And then, are there any other ideas? How much more time do we have to talk about this?
There's also the
just a couple more minutes.
Involvement with the schools, the drawing contest.
That's already. I already sent that out.
Yep.
So I forwarded that to all the fifth grade or all the elementary schools. Hill School and to Landon Green School on Prospect Street. So anyone that in Northampton it's got to be Northampton school, can be public or private. That's a great class. So.
Right. And then another thing that we can do is reach out to schools or clubs in schools about actual helping with planting, because we know now that younger kids can help if we do bare root. Mm-hmm.
I was wondering if. I like the idea of adding the tree planting. Do we feel that it would be possible to take on some additional type of educational event? Or do we just want to be out there handing out planting? I mean, we could do like a half-day program or a morning program, afternoon program, where we get speakers, do demonstrations, have things to hand out.
We're talking about that also on the campus.
All right.
With our group.
Yeah, and then we were talking about coordinating with you.
Yeah, so we're talking about different educational things that would be a component of that.
So we could do it in partnership with Smith.
We'll have to see what we can come up with. But.
And what day or what time frame are they looking at?
We were thinking of earlier in April. For the educational part, at least, because that week is the end of school for Smith, and the week before exams. So we probably wouldn't get a lot of student participation at that point. So we were thinking at least the educational part going a little earlier.
That'd be worthwhile. So it'd still be in April, sort of Arbor Day month.
Yeah.
We could partner with Smith.
Birthday, Arbor Day, kind of.
Being an employee there, do you feel like Smith would be open to allowing others to partner?
We're going to talk about the different events, so we should probably talk about that between now and
Okay.
Next meeting.
So we've got potentially three things that we're cooking.
Yeah.
Planting, distributing writs, and having some kind of an educational component, hopefully, in collaboration with Smith.
In the school drawing.
Yeah. Oh, and the post, right, the poster.
Yeah.
Right. Great. Any other suggestions? We're going to keep this on the agenda for every meeting, so. All right, and if we need to get a WIP order in, then you guys are going to coordinate looking at that list and potentially...
WIP order or...
I'm sorry, I didn't mean WIP. The Bear.
Yeah. I'd like to, I mean, it's good to know what we'll have. Partly because people are really wanting some setback planting, so when I speak to them, it's great if I could say that.
Great, okay. Anything else? All right, that's it for Arbor Day. And then the next topic is, okay, so the big question is, do we proceed with the municipal tree nursery? And then of course, this would just be a recommendation to the city, because Rich, this is really your bailiwick. So it's more like just having some sort of advice to put forward. You have a take on Andrew?
All right,
thanks for coming.
Can I ask Andrew something just so we have his view? You really like to see a nursery.
I think it makes sense to have a small something that you can handpick yourself.
Okay.
Or the monitor and just play with what you might not be able to get from somewhere every year. I think it makes sense to, you know, you're thinking 10 years from now. Less in terms of implementation, so let's see what we can buy easily and try to plant that. You know, I think that makes sense.
Okay.
But I don't know if it makes sense. I think it depends.
Okay.
One of the comments, because you've actually done it, built a nursery and you're leaving, so
yeah, I know.
It's good. But so now we have your words. Thank you.
Those are
see ya.
Yeah, tree nursery.
All right, does someone want to start this conversation?
I think all the comments from other people that have done it say start small. I think we're going to get better selection if we do it. I think starting small is a good idea. So I'm for going ahead with it.
Can we, when we say start small, that's don't put in too many trees all at once, space them in, but the size of the infrastructure would be big enough for a fair number of trees. In other words, the fence and the irrigation, is that right? Sort of two different things, the infrastructure and then don't put in too many trees.
I'd like to zoom out a little bit and ask ourselves, like, you know, what are our goals and what's the most efficient way of getting there? And it seems to me like from, you know, expert after expert that I was able to talk to, they said it's a lot of work and it's best for, as Andrew said, for having control over stock that you can't easily source elsewhere. And from Alan, who I really put a huge amount of weight into, this is a guy who has, you know, decades of experience, and he's surveyed municipalities all over the state, and he's not invested in what we do, has said, I don't do it because it's not more worth my time.
I interpreted what he said differently.
And well, I spoke to him.
Yeah.
And what he said is that I've sanctioned. I've given my blessing to the tree committee to start to maintain a very small, specialized nursery. Mm-hmm. He has no involvement in it, and he says, and you know, I would like them to stay at that size because I think that's all they need.
I think there's a way that we could perhaps experiment with this, you know, just to see how worthwhile it is. I mean, from that big perspective point of view, I mean, if climate change bears down on this as it's predicted to, I feel like this would be a great resource and asset to have, you know, our own nursery. I mean, who knows how the climate and the weather conditions are going to impact vegetation systems, but it seems like it would be worth at least our experimentation just to start taking steps towards doing this. And I think the partnership approach is the best way. Like, we don't have to do it all on our own. Like, what other groups in the city, colleges, other organizations, businesses, could we link with so that this really is, you know, something that not only benefits the city, but that has many hands of people in the city at least collaborating on and helping us to build it.
I just want to go back to Alan. I thought what he said was he didn't consider it because he had a short time frame and a contract.
No, that was bare root. He didn't consider bare root planting because he had already had a contract right. with Amherst Nursery right. for their stock.
Right.
But he has never considered a municipal nursery. Mm-hmm. And he said, it's not worth my time. Mm-hmm. And I really pressed him on that and really tried to understand what his feeling was about it, and he just said, you know, my working as a community first forester around the state for so many years, I saw so many municipalities be overwhelmed by their nursery, it taking way more time than they anticipated. And I have a little glimpse of this because, you know, I started Grow Food Northampton, and we started a community garden within this 120 acre. You know, parcel of land, and this tiny community garden, which comprises probably 2 acres of the 121 acres, took 80% of our time. Mm-hmm. You know, when you're actually doing on the ground work of management, you know, mowing it, irrigating it, it's expensive and it's staff heavy, and it just there's just a million more details than you would ever anticipate.
I'm against the volunteer-driven nursery, and I'm also against 100% city-driven nursery. But I would like to explore that the idea of leasing city land to an already established nursery on the condition of X percentage of the stock grown is for city use, and we decide what gets planted, et cetera, et cetera. But the rest of the land can be used for the private entity to do is, you know, grow their own stock. But you lease it to them for a buck a year, it's surplus property, they got the infrastructure, you know,
so we,
the people in place, and they're professional nurserymen, and it's just a portion of that stock that is grown is for city use.
But the city invest money in infrastructure, though, in irrigation.
The city gives land away for a buck.
No, so doesn't supply the infrastructure for irrigation or?
Well, hopefully it'd be on a site that's not a big deal, but that having a private sector entity that knows what they're doing, has the scale already set up to do that, I think would be at least worth exploring. There's probably 100 things that could go wrong, including infrastructure and irrigation and fencing, et cetera, but it takes, you know, a ton of stuff off the table, and it's really this, finding some land, putting out an RFQ or some sort of request for expressions of interest, and seeing what pops up.
Who might be actually working in the nursery to make this work, Rich, from in your vision? I mean, would the tree crew go out there and tend the trees? I want to say that I'm assuming we're using tree bags, so the amount of work is greatly reduced.
I would say that if we're going to do this, I think I like Alan's idea of doing a very small, limited amount of trees to start with. If we don't have the, I like Todd's actually idea because you're actually creating a RFQ, sort of like a timber contract. It'd be like for a buck. You give the contractor the land to use, sort of like you give the contractor the lumber. You cut all the lumber down. We want it gone, and you know, we will take whatever X amount of dollars from the timber contract, or we will take X amount of trees from the contract after they have been established. So you could have a nursery who, or a, for example, let's say Amherst Nursery wanted to expand, for example. They could actually come over here and actually have a piece of land like Linden World, which would be, I don't know how many acres that is, I think.
For free, for 99 years.
And they, and provided they provide us with X amount of trees per year. Now, the problem with that, I suppose, is that, yes, 100 things could go wrong with it. The economy could tank. They could have to pull out. Then we would be stuck with all these trees in the nursery that now we have to find a way to maintain, which could be a problem. I don't think we should pass up the opportunity to create a nursery. I think we should, if we're going to do it, I think it should be a small nursery. My experience with the nursery that we have had here with Smith Vocational is that, unfortunately, the DPW provided the trees to be planted in the nursery. We bought the bare root stock for them, the kids to plant. They planted it. Administration's changed at the school. Next thing you know, the trees are now 12 years old, and they're huge, and now they have to be cut down, just like Alan foretold in your interview. They were cut down. They had to be thrown away. The stumps were pulled. Huge waste of time. We're kind of bordering on that problem now at Smith Folk again, because those trees have not been moved. So, and that nursery, I think, is just, that nursery in particular, there's just too many trees in it. I think we have to have the ability to manage this nursery with a small amount of trees to begin with, and we have to have a fallback plan if, for some reason, the volunteer group that we have falls apart, that we have city forces, because in the end, the city owns the land, the city owns the trees, the city's gonna be responsible for doing something with the trees, whether it's putting them out and planting them, or having to cut them down if something goes terribly wrong. But I think it would be a shame to pass up the land that's available to us in Glendale Road, provided the soil samples come back properly, and not have some kind of a small established nursery for stock that we normally would have struggled getting, and making that commitment, a small one to start with. But also looking at, I don't know if there's any other examples statewide of that, I have no idea, but that's all, that's interesting to me, because that really takes the, That takes the burden right off of all of us, in a sense. It's like going to a vendor and just buying trees. It makes it really simple.
I mean, so did you have your hand up?
Oh, no.
Oh, okay. I like the words start small. I don't like the word start small because it suggests that we grow something bigger. And everything I've heard makes me feel uncomfortable about that. I'm just trying to be brutally rational about this, and I don't see this as the most efficient way to reach our goal of retreating Northampton. I think we need to keep a laser focus on once we have the inventory, on getting trees in the ground and creating a plan for managing our trees going forward. And this feels like a diversion to me, especially when, you know, the person who has had the most experience around the state says, I don't want to do it.
I agree. Just read over those things that we got about the tree nurseries, and the people who are really against it, there was one guy who inherited an overgrown nursery and had to reclaim it, and once he got a hold on it, he seemed to like the idea. Springfield is making it work.
No, he didn't like it. He still didn't like it. Okay. I think you're referring to Lexington.
There was an old problem. Two of them didn't like it. Two of them. We're making it work.
Yeah, the one in Springfield had turned it around. But they have a huge staff, Jay. Just a huge staff compared to us. So that's, you know, that I just look at what we are equipped with, and what is the most efficient route to our goals, and this doesn't feel like it.
There's another issue is that we have the opportunity to start the nursery now. And there could come a time, not too long from now, when the trees that are grown in the nursery are pretty much the only trees that are available to us, just for financial reasons. So it does kind of guarantee a long-term supply of low-cost trees.
And to me, the big reason for having one is if you don't have one, you're really limiting the variety of trees you're going to get.
So I'm compelled by that. And I do agree that trees that we can't source through other means or that are prohibitively expensive, that we should exclusively reserve a very small nursery for that. The things that worry me are, I feel like Glendale, it's like it's the Wild West out there. It's so far away, it's so easy to like forget land out there. So I just worry that, you know, we get something established out there and we don't manage it. And I hear your vision. It's a little bit like what Grow Food has done with farmers leasing our land. But if we can't identify a tree nursery, like an established tree nursery that really knows how to grow trees, that wants to lease that land, then I wouldn't feel comfortable putting the city in the position of leasing that land to people with no experience. Because I don't think that that's really worth our time. I mean, and we did do that with Grow Food, a couple rounds of farmers. They just didn't work out because they really didn't have the requisite experience to manage.
Yeah, I wouldn't mess around with that as an incubator site.
Yeah, so I think it's worth identifying a few regional nurseries and seeing if they would want more land, but I wouldn't approve that plan until we really had a good, an interested party.
What were you going to say,
I'm not so much compelled by the, you know, rare species element as I am change in administration, purse goes empty, and the commission is left doing nothing for 8 years in a row because there's no money.
Okay, let's think about that one. I guess I would ask, is a municipal tree nursery really going to save us? Like, first of all, we're not guaranteed that those trees will provide us with good tree plant. I mean, numbers of nurseries found that the tree stock wasn't actually even worth moving and planting. So I feel like there's not yet that guarantee that just because we put trees in a nursery that we have them to move to street trees.
If it's a volunteer or city-run nursery, I totally agree with you. But if you're handing over, you know, a 50 to 100 plant municipal nursery to a professional nursery company,
okay,
with
so
certain
that,
criteria, then
that is your only vision of a nursery that you'd want us to consider.
I would be in the skeptical column of spending a whole lot of time on a municipal or volunteer run. In fact, I would not support a volunteer run nursery. It's gonna fail.
Why do you feel like if it was well organized enough, do you feel like?
Because my dad's a nurseryman and I grew up on a nursery and I know what it takes to grow a nursery.
Sometimes when I'm working with groups, I like to do like, you know, visioning exercises, like, you know, what's like your ideal like headline news, you know, like you look at the paper above the fold. I mean, I would love to just envision like our group helping to create something that really becomes not just successful but a model for success. So I'm just curious, like what would it take for that to happen? Whether it's a business model or multiple partnership model, or, you know, get a school involved.
Well, it would take some effort on the DPW's part. I mean, I'm not sure in terms of success how much energy can come from DPW.
Good point. I think the point that you brought up about change administration, I went through that cycle once. We already had that here, but we ended up actually having a director that slashed up the whole tree budget.
Yeah.
Gonzo.
But if we got a bond, right? That money is guaranteed. I mean, that's what Amherst did. They bonded $600,000.
Right.
That was dedicated money for planting 2,000 trees. So
that's different though. We're talking about long term. So if you're doing long term, if we're going to do a long term investment in a nursery, even if it's a small nursery, let's say it's 20 plants, that if somewhere down the road the administration decides that we're going to reduce the tree crew to 2 people and we're not going to be planting trees for the next 3 years because there's no money, then these guys have to go out on the street and take care of the trees. The volunteer organization falls apart, or the multiple partnership organization. Then we're stuck with a nursery that we can't sustain. It's kind of what happened in Smith Folk. Yeah. Smith Folk's nursery was actually maintained by the students. And then in the summertime was maintained by the forestry department two teachers. The forestry department, they were told because of budget cuts that they can no longer be paid extra to work in the summer months. Even though they're paid anyways, they were paid extra. And they had students, that was all disbanded. So next thing you know, the nursery, the grass is 5 feet tall and the whips are totally buried and you're in there with a weed whacker and you're cutting everything down and that's the end of it. So that's what we have to be careful to avoid if we're gonna go forward with this. I don't know, I mean, I planted trees for the last 25 years basically by purchasing them outright from nurseries. It was the most cleanest, easiest, quickest way to get trees into the ground. And that was really what the goal is to really get trees into the ground and to actually just reforest our canopy. How we go about that is I don't see we're gonna stop doing that, but I think by planting, possibly obtaining land and planting a small nursery and having a multiple partnership organization help maintain it, small one, would probably be successful. But it's also gonna take another group of volunteers that will be attached to another group of volunteers that will be reporting to another commissioner. If we're gonna, so we're gonna have these multiple volunteer groups that are gonna be part of this that are all really, everything is funneled through the city eventually. And so if the city can't sustain all these things we started, then we're in a lot of trouble. So that's the part that scares me, is that I don't have any control over what happens in the future. I mean, like I said, we had a full-time tree crew 25 years ago, and then next thing you know, we have a two-man tree crew with no money. No money to fix a tree truck. I mean, it's we've been there before. I don't think we're gonna go back there, but I can't say that we're not going to, because you can have an administration and you can have a director who is not interested in trees.
Well, it comes down to, are we gonna lay off a fireman or a teacher, or are we gonna have trees?
Is it possible that we don't need to answer this question now because we actually don't need to deal with a tree nursery now? I mean, I know that I'm feeling the whole pressure of the Glendale site, but really, it seems to me like what we need to do now is focus on doing a major replanting of Northampton, and that we have some good sources of trees for getting most of our tree needs met.
I think you're right, Billy, and what both of you have said. I think we need to go up now. Is probably the time when we need to go up 30,000 feet and just lay out what are we going to do this year, what are the priorities, and how we're going to tackle some of these key things. I think inventory, pursuing bond, whatever the case may be, but I do think we have to kind of set boom, 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 what we're gonna get done in the next 12 months, and then what we are going to start to incubate and build upon for the longer term, which I would put the nursery in that category.
Okay, so that sounds like that's an agenda item for next meeting. Like, we can't figure that out in the next 3 minutes.
But oh, no, that's like a 40-minute discussion.
It's
a
huge,
with a whiteboard.
Yeah. Except Todd's going to come in as a guest. Who's the nursery man?
He's available?
Because, because when I zoom way out, and I really want us to see, I really want to see us reach our goals, our highest and most important goals. And when I zoom out and I identify what they are, the nursery just doesn't, at this point, fit into our highest and most important goals. I think it may, on some scale, my scale would probably be way smaller than what some other people's scale would be, but it just doesn't feel like it has that urgency that other things, for me, feel more urgent.
Well, that may be a question just to start our conversation next time, just do like a pros and cons, like, what benefit would a nursery here in Northampton provide?
I think we talked about that last meeting.
I mean, we've heard from a lot of communities. So I really think at this point we've just got to ask ourselves what are our highest and most immediate priorities.
And I think you're right. I think when we ask ourselves, what do you want to get done in the next 12 months? If someone says build a municipal nursery. Okay, well, I'll be surprised if that comes out as a, top tier item in the next 12 months. It might be something where, continue to percolate, explore some ideas, whatever the case may be, on a lower level. But I think we have
much more pungent fish to fry, you know, in 12 months.
There's something that we're going to be investigating soon. What is the supply of trees? In other words, can we successfully plant bare trees in large numbers? I think starting with 25 is a really good idea, because then we'll see what it takes to do it.
Well, we know that very, very large cities do
in
very, very large numbers, so.
Right. But I think that when you get the trees, do we have a volunteer force that will come out? How much time do we really have before they need to be damaged? What's the percentage that are successful? And then the other question is, Amherst Nursery, will they come up with trees that we want or not? Eventually they will, because some of their other contracts are diminishing. But I mean, there's a real question of, I mean, we were disappointed in the supply that we got.
Yeah. So. Well, you said yourself you came to the table late. I mean, so that's where, again, all of my research, to me, heard people over and over again say, I've had a lot of success shifting to bare root planting, and no problem with supplies, plenty of interesting variety. You know, sure, some weren't there, but success after success. And so, I mean, I can only go on what we've heard, and so far I've heard lots of great things. So for me, it feels like that feels more sure than I'm going toward a municipal nursery. All right, so I want to make sure that we're wrapping up, and I want to give just a little bit of time and other business for Todd's ordinance document. Does anyone feel like they can help me find some wrap-up statements about this conversation? Or are we all over the place?
No, I think personally that I started talking, I was thinking the fact that I'm still using a list that we have from Northampton Tree Committee of approved city street trees.
Yeah.
So it's almost like we're kind of putting the cart before the horse in a certain sense. We have to identify what kind of trees we actually want to plant. Then we have to identify where we're going to get them from. And then the ones that we can't get anywhere are the ones that we would actually put in the nursery. So it's like the nursery is like on the end of this program. I think the nursery idea is a good idea. I think it needs to have a little more research, but I think in the short term, we've talked about the inventory and actually identifying the sites and finding a way to get the trees planted at those sites and going forward and having that probably be one of the biggest goals of the commission in 2016, mm-hmm. starting to do that. So I think somewhere along the line, we have to identify, we have to come to a conclusion whether or not we actually want to make a small nursery, but we really don't know what we're going to want in the nursery, because we don't really know what kind of trees we're going to need to put in the nursery based upon what's available and what we actually would like. So I think we need to sit down, and actually maybe a few of us sit down and talk about the kind of trees that we want to plant in the city, what we're actually looking for. This would be a good time to figure that out, and very quickly, so we can put an order in. And then if we can't find X, Y, and Z tree species, then we would say, okay, we would like to get 20 of these bare root trees and plant them somewhere, and start small, but farther down the road, I think.
Okay.
I don't know if that helps wrap it up, but I think that it's.
I think that's good, because we haven't really found out what trees we can acquire and whether we like the stock that we get, right?
Okay, so I think I'm hearing, don't want to put words in anyone's mouth, but I think I'm hearing that we're realizing that forming a municipal nursery may not be a 2016 priority, given that we don't know what kind of trees we want and all of the things that the inventory will tell us. We don't have that information yet.
I would agree with that.
There's certain pieces of information that need to come first, but perhaps whether it's in 4 months, 6 months, or at the end of next year, just I think it's worth revisiting every periodically, whatever that period is. Okay, now that we've done the inventory, now that we've done this, that, or the other, what do we think now about the tree and
okay.
the tree nursery?
So do we want to table this topic until January of 2017, or until?
No. Not that far.
As Marilyn just said,
yeah,
I think revisit it.
4 to 6 months.
Well, it's really about the inventory. The inventory is going to provide so much information, and we won't have that in 4 months.
So
why don't we table it to June? Because I think it's let June, you can touch on it, and then we'll see where we're at.
Yeah, okay.
Inventory-wise, and then we'll also have, we'll have the ability to sit down and talk about the type of trees that actually want to plant in out of the streets.
What we want to plant and what we think we can get, market.
Well, we will know we'll get because we'll ask.
Yeah.
Then we have to find out what kind of, we have to look at that list that we have, so maybe the three, I'm suggesting that maybe the three of us.
Yeah.
If anyone else wants to, the three of us sit down and talk about that list if you have time. About the list that we have, the old list that we have, and then making changes to the list based upon what we think would be good street tree selection, based upon what we planted this year and what's new and coming. And we'll probably actually get a list next week of, they always do that, top 10 new street trees that are planted.
Yeah.
At the tree wards and foresters.
A Zocovia won the year, tree of the year,
so.
I don't understand that.
I don't understand that either. I don't agree with that, but that's fine. That's,
okay.
So,
all right, yeah. So we agree that we're gonna pick this discussion back up in June. And then I also just want to acknowledge that there is a diversity of opinion around the table about whether or not to start a tree nursery. Okay, all right, other business. Todd, would you like to take a moment to tell us a little bit about, I know, I'm sorry, Todd.
No, sorry.
And if you want, we can table it completely for
no, I think it's just worth reading, just, so this is, what I tried to put together is just my thoughts on, I think what we're going to be doing is really doing more than just creating a public shade tree protection ordinance. I think what ideally we should work on is a collaborative effort across departments, including the planning department, CONCOM, DPW, and really coordinate how we address trees in all of the permitting aspects that members of the public go through when they're going through land-based permits and what have you. So just touching on some of the permits, and I think, you know, we've seen this anecdotally already where, you know, they get approval in one area, but because the submittal requirements aren't standard across the board when it comes to street trees, there's ambiguity on what the next phases of the process are and what have you. So starting with the submittal requirements, making sure that no matter what you're doing, you're submitting a standard set of plans that have a standard set of information on them that then the tree warden can be responsible for looking at and signing off on in various stages of all of these types of projects, so that you know the tree warden would be involved in anything that has to do with street trees, not just when it comes to getting the specific permit for the street tree removal. So there can be a voice throughout the process. So if that driveway had, you know, could have been shifted X, Y, and Z to mitigate the removal of street trees, you could have been involved in that process and kind of give the public shade trees a voice in the beginning of the process. And then carrying it all the way through to then the tree protection ordinance itself, getting our hands, you know, our handle on that list, making it more comprehensive, referencing the various sections of code, either creating them ourselves or referencing the already pieces of code that exist and regulations and standards that are professionally adhered to, referencing all those internally for the protection of during construction, how you take the measurement of, you know, breast height diameter, et cetera. And then working into the inspection enforcement, and then finally figuring out the penalties and fines, and if the mayor still wants to play some odd part of that, or if we can tighten that up and just make it a much more straightforward process across the board. So that was in a gist what that outline was meant to kind of represent, how going to try to, I think we have to kind of get our arms around quite a bit of stuff and not just put in a public shade tree protection ordinance that ignores, I think, some of the systemic problems that we're already seeing.
So, are you, what, time for questions?
Sure.
Yeah. So, regulation guidelines, just go to King Street where there are the auto dealer stand.
Huh?
Put some tree there. Don't go there, right? Put some in the public right away, and then have some not in the public right away. So the regulation guidelines would definitely apply to the ones in the regulation guidelines, apply to the ones in the tree belt, right? The public trees, how they planted them and what,
yes,
how they maintained them and all
that. Yeah. what species there are, what types are planted, where, if there's power lines, that doesn't mean you don't get to plant nothing. You get to plant something that's appropriate for under power lines.
But then as soon as it's in their parking lot, then this wouldn't apply, but you're saying it would be good. It would help.
You can still regulate that.
You can still regulate that based upon, because if the
it's a zoning.
Right, if the blueprint is over 2,000 square feet, then it goes right across the hall.
So you would tie this together with across the hall.
Correct. Zoning.
That's all I'm asking. I'm just making sure that that's, because I see this as like the one, a really, really important aspect of what can be regulated in terms of trees. I mean.
So if, just give you an example, 623 Kennedy Road, the only reason that had to go to CONSCOM is because they were in the 100-foot buffer zone of an aquifer recharge zone. So if they were on Crafts Avenue over here, they would not have been involved. The only thing, they would have come to the DPW for a permit, and then I would have gone out and done the same thing I just did the other day. So it's all these different little triggers that cause all these different, I mean, there's a whole page full of information here, which is interesting, causes these little nuances to, this ordinance applies, this ordinance does not apply. This gets reviewed by planning board. This does not go before DPW until planning board reviews it, that type of thing. So that's
so this seems urgent, you know.
That's great. Where we kind of get into trouble.
And that leaves you kind of at the tail end, or, you know, watching it kind of go by in the mail cart. You're like, right. Oh, what about that?
Yeah.
So,
right.
But instead of a very concrete system where if it involves the public right away and, you know, there are trees in it, you see it.
Yeah, right. So this could potentially affect many ordinances that already exist?
It could supplement and help. It wouldn't.
Would it require some kind of a official amendment of numbers of ordinances?
Yes.
Okay, so this is a beast.
Yeah, it's
yeah. Yeah, okay. Just trying to figure out the scale of this challenge here. All right, and so I think, I mean, this all makes sense to me. This makes great sense to have Rich position to always be flagged when anything related to public shade trees are affected. Just looking at a house on Massasoit Street, you know that one?
Mm-hmm.
Where there's this big pile of earth just jammed up against a public shade tree. And I'm just wondering, at what stage were you brought in that, if ever?
I wasn't brought into that until they didn't need a trench permit to actually pour the foundation, because a trench permit triggers my action with it, because it's on private property. The foundation footings do not require a trench permit.
But the fact that they're piling
now, now it requires that because they did a water and sewer entry. So then the flag gets risen because now we have to have a trench permit. So that's how I find out about this.
Okay, so that's an example.
Or unless somebody tells me that there's something going on.
Right. So that's an example where in the permitting process there's got to be like, would there be any public shade trees affected by any of this disturbance? Yeah. So, this is all very new to me, so I just don't know what next. Like, how do we start to, pick this apart in manageable pieces?
Well, that's a really good question. And I'm not sure how, I can definitely take a lead on it, but, you know, these are city ordinances, usually controlled by specific city departments. So, I don't know if a meeting with planning director is the right move, or.
I think actually probably sitting all these folks down in a room. So you really, DPW permits would be someone like myself. Building permits would be Louis Hasbrook. Planning department would be Wayne. Planning commission would be Wayne. Conservation commission would be Sarah LaValle would be there. Zoning Board of Appeals, I'm not sure. So you have to sit everyone down in a room and have a conversation. Because in reality, the department heads will actually recommend changes to the city ordinance, and they'll recommend the changes to the mayor. And the mayor will approve them and actually run them through the council. But they have to have, it goes through committee, obviously, and has to have a councilor sponsor it. And it's going to require a lot of input from the folks that I just mentioned. And they have to support it all, so they can actually go back to these different commissions and basically sell it.
How do we get them to care about this? How do we get them to show up to a meeting like that? And I am aware that it's 6 o'clock, and I want to respect, especially paid staff. So maybe, should we continue this discussion at the next, at a future meeting? Because it feels like we're just scratching the surface.
Yeah, this was just meant as an opening.
Okay, all right. So I'm just going to write to be.
Big one, yeah.
Well, I'll give you 15 minutes.
I didn't even get that. All right, I think we're done. To do wrap-ups, I really like to try to make a commitment to get us out on time, so I'm actually going to ask Marilyn, okay, let me just finish my sentence, because what I might do is, is anyone rushing to get out?
No.
Okay, then we'll go for another 3 or 4 minutes to do wrap-up. Go for it.
Okay. All right, Rich, I have you asking Pam about the status of the ordinance.
Yes.
Lily following up with the mayor about DPW hiring process, and then a question from our committee. Mm-hmm. Rich reaching out to Alan regarding the tree fund. Oh, no, sorry. Yeah, the tree fund. How does Amherst do it?
Yeah.
And then Jay just checking with Smith College regarding the Arbor Day educational events. Perhaps how we might be able to partner with them. That's all I have. I might have missed something.
Yeah, I have Jay contact Reed Green about volunteer organizing tips. Let's see.
Yeah, that's what I have to.
Okay. Okie dokie. Motion to adjourn this meeting.
I've got just one statement.
Okay.
There's a good webinar tomorrow at noontime webinar about soil research on tree root and stuff that they're doing at Cornell. Probably the latest tree root research this woman is doing at Cornell. It's free. You got an hour between noon and one. Yeah, no, it's not in the best.
Okay.
I can send you the link tomorrow morning.
Okay.
I'll just send it to everybody.
Thank you. All right, do we have a motion to adjourn this meeting?
I make a motion to adjourn this meeting.
Sorry.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, motion adjourned. I mean, meeting adjourned. Motion adjourned.